It is time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister.
For the next premier. Wow. That's not helpful when I'm trying to get the other side. If all indications continue, I will go to warnings immediately. If you'd like to test me, I will fulfill. Question, please.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Finance. The Liberals need to open their eyes and realize that life is too expensive in Ontario. They need to open their eyes and realize that 416 and 905 commuters can't afford these new Liberal tolls. The attack on commuters must end. There is no doubt. Mr. Speaker, my question to the government is, will they make a U-turn before toll booths are on the ramps of the Gardner and the DVP? Do they not appreciate that commuters can't afford this giant new toll?
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And commuters and the people of Ontario appreciate this. You need to make decisions. You need to ensure that we continue to invest in our infrastructure. You continue to look forward to the future, Mr. Speaker, and you continue to be open-minded about what is being proposed. No decision has been made. The Council hasn't even reflected on the recommendations and suggestions being put forward by the Mayor, and the member opposite has put no ideas whatsoever forward in order to relieve the issue that's before us, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Let people keep their own money. They'll spend it.
Mr. Speaker, again to the minister, let's hear what stakeholders are saying about this. The Durham chair, Roger Anderson, had this to say about the Liberal plan to allow taxes on Toronto roads. He said, I quote, "I think this is a short-sighted solution. They're literally taxing the 905 to pay for roads that have already been paid for." Anderson said that tolls will end up hurting businesses. He concluded, "I think this is going to backfire." I agree with the Durham chair that this is going to backfire. The government is forcing people of Ontario to pay for roads they've already paid for. So my question is this to the Minister of Finance. I know the Durham Liberal MPPs must be pleading with the Minister of Finance not to put this tax on Durham. I hope they're doing that. So the question is to the Minister of Finance, will he heed the advice of the Durham chair? Will he take advice from Durham Liberal MPPs and not impose this toll?
I thank the member for his comment because I'm moving to warnings. And we'll go quick. The Minister of Indigenous Relations and Reconciliation is warned. Anyone next? Applies for both sides. Minister?
Minister of Transportation, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I thank the leader opposite for his question. You know, to follow up on what the Minister of Finance said in his first answer, Speaker, everyone on this side of the House, everyone in Durham, everyone in the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area understands very clearly where this government stands with respect to making sure that the transportation and transit system that we committed to in 2014 gets fully built, Speaker. And you know, to cite Chair Roger Anderson from Durham in the House in the context of that question is a little bit, it's a little bit surprising to me, Speaker, because I got to tell you, anytime I've had the chance to speak with any of our members from Durham or the chair himself, I've heard him celebrate the two-way all-day GO service we're delivering, the support for the Durham BRT, the 407 Phase 1 and Phase 2 that we're currently building out to the 35-115, Speaker. That chair and our members understand we believe in producing results, not running away from the tough questions. That leader could take a lesson from us. Thanks very much, Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. And I always remind members to refer to the chair when answering and asking questions. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Minister of Finance, it's not just the Mayor of Mississauga, it's not just the Durham chair. It's most of the municipal leaders in the 905 saying this is a reckless, bad Liberal tax. Let's hear what someone else said. Just listen to the mayor of Oshawa, John Henry. I had no prior heads up until I heard about this on the radio this morning. Would I support it? No. Henry.
Stop the clock. The Minister of Agriculture is warned. The Minister of Municipal Affairs is warned. I'm resolute. Please finish your question.
Mr. Speaker, I know the Liberal members opposite don't like hearing what municipal mayors are saying about this Liberal tax, but let me continue. The mayor of Oshawa continued by saying there is just no money left that people have. They can't afford these tolls. So there's no mandate. In 2014, the premier did not run on tolling the DVP and the Gardner. The mayors are saying no. Commuters are saying no. Why are they giving the City of Toronto this permission?
Question.
Why do they want to tax the DVP and the Gardner? It's wrong and the people can't afford it.
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. Listen, I got to tell you, 2 years and 5 months that I've been serving as the Minister of Transportation, Speaker, in every corner of the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area.
The member from Chatham-Kent-Essex is warned. Carry on.
Speaker, in every corner of the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area, what I hear from both commuters and from municipal leaders is their strong support for the transportation plan that our Premier and our government are delivering, Speaker. Go Regional Express Rail, the Eglinton Crosstown, the Finch West Crosstown, the Finch West LRT, the Here Ontario LRT in Mississauga, Speaker, the Hamilton LRT. The list is literally endless. But, Speaker, I have to share with the House. When I talk to municipal representatives in the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area and beyond, and when I talk to residents in every single community that I just referenced, they have a question for me. They want to know where the leader of the Conservative Party stands on transit funding and transportation funding, and more importantly, they want to know why 10 years in Ottawa he was MIA on these very issues.
Your question, the Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, since I can't get an answer on the Liberal tolls, the DVP and Gardner, I'll try something new. A question for the Minister of the Environment. A billion-dollar capital project that could lead to 1,000 jobs during construction and another 400 to 500 full-time jobs during the operation sounds fantastic. But that very project that I'm describing is being held up by this government's red tape. The provincial and federal environmental assessment started in the same time in 2013. The federal government approved the project in April, but the provincial deadline of July 22nd came and went. Mr. Speaker, why is the Minister of the Environment single-handedly holding up the billion-dollar Côté gold mine project near Timmins for no reason whatsoever? Why are we the slowest place to do business in Canada?
Thank you. Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
So, Mr. Speaker, over the last 2 years, we have gone through major reforms in turnaround time because the wait times when I became minister were long. Some of them were taking up to 2 years, and we had some real challenges. What is actually happening now is on January 1st, we will be introducing measures that will cut those turnaround times in half.
Wow.
And as members are also aware, we are computerizing and operating on the ESER system, which will give us some of the fastest turnaround times in the country. As to the particular of the complexity of a gold mine, I know the member for Nickel Belt and I have been discussing that and raising that. We are reviewing it right now, and I will assure the member opposite it will be dealt with expeditiously. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Minister of the Environment. A billion-dollar project. The local community on board. The local Indigenous populations on board. The federal government on board. Yet this government continues to wage this unexplained war against Ontario's mining industry. Yep. Not only did the minister miss his legislative deadline in July, yep, but now he's asking local groups for reasons to oppose the project because he can't come up with any himself. You know, the deadline to respond? Mid-December, more than 5 months after your own legislated deadline. But there's hope, Mr. Speaker. There's hope because the Auditor General is reporting tomorrow on environmental assessment delays just like this one. So, Mr. Speaker, the minister has seen the report. Did he pass with flying colors, or is what's happening with a billion-dollar Côté mining project the norm in this province, and we are the province of red tape? Please tell us, Minister.
Thank you. Minister.
So, when the party opposite was in power, there was almost zero reform in this area, Mr. Speaker. Since Premier Wynne came into power,
She immediately directed the reform of the EBR, which is underway, the ECA system, which is underway, and the environmental assessments, which are moving to a highly automated ESER system. This is groundbreaking, national-leading reforms that will make us one of the user-friendly and simplest systems to use. With the particular issue of gold mines, it's interesting because we have major proposals coming forward from several gold mines in Ontario right now for major reinvestment. As the Minister of Northern Development would tell you, it's a very dynamic, a very exciting time for mining in Ontario, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the minister. The Côté Gold Project is reflective of this government's contempt for the North and their failure to get projects moving. Just look at the Ring of Fire. The press releases from 2012 were written as if the Chromite mine was a done deal. It touted thousands of jobs coming to Northern Ontario and has quotes from five ministers, including the current premier, that the deal was done. The release was followed with years of empty, empty promises. And the failure to act on the Ring of Fire is an embarrassment for this government. So, Mr. Speaker, it's been years since the Ring of Fire hasn't moved forward at all. Now the Côté Gold Project is experiencing the same neglect, the same red tape. When will this government finally commit to making sure the incredible potential of the North is seized? We don't need any more delays. We don't need more red tape. We want this government to support the northern mining opportunities. Can I have a justification from the minister?
Thank you. Minister?
Mr. Speaker, we have a working committee in Cabinet led by the Minister of Northern Development and Mines specifically working on this. But I find this passing strange, Mr. Speaker, coming from a former federal member, when we were twinning northern highways, spending five times what that government did in the north, 500% more twinning highways, he never raised a peak, Mr. Speaker. We are out. We had no federal matching money. 90% of northern highways are paid for by the government of Ontario. Not a red cent or a word for the member opposite. He sat back while money poured into Alberta for the oil sands, no investment in green energy, no investment in the Ring of Fire, nothing.
Answer.
He was a member from Alberta for the amount of good he was to us in Ontario, and now he has the nerve to criticize the government that's paying one.
Thank you. Stop the clock. Stop the clock. You see it, please? You see it, please?
We're still on warnings. New question. The member from Bramley-Gormalton.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Keeping the fridge on, running a pump to get water from the well, or running a baseboard heater aren't luxuries. These are necessities. These are basics. Does the Acting Premier think it's okay that working people and seniors can't afford these basics because hydro bills are so high?
Deputy Premier.
Minister of Energy.
Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm happy to rise to answer that question because it is an important question. It is something that we recognize that there are families, there are seniors out there, Mr. Speaker, that are having a difficult time paying their electricity bills. And that's why, Mr. Speaker, we brought forward from the speech from the throne the 8% reduction, the 20% reduction, Mr. Speaker, for the 330,000 families that qualify for that, Mr. Speaker. We know that there more needs to be done, Mr. Speaker, but that's why we continue to talk about the programs that we have in place. The Ontario Electricity Support Program, Mr. Speaker, for example, it can provide up to $45 per month for those families that qualify, and for seniors, Mr. Speaker, and for those that actually need to plug in, for example, a piece of medical equipment, Mr. Speaker, they can actually get up to $75 a month to help on their hydro bills, Mr. Speaker. We know that there's more to do. The Premier talked about that a few weeks ago. My ministry is working very hard on that, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
We'll continue to find ways to help families, to help seniors, to help everyone across the province with their electricity.
Thank you. Commentary.
Mr. Speaker, I asked the government to listen very carefully to the story of Bob and Janine. Bob and Janine thought they'd be able to afford to retire. They had budgeted to live on old age and CPP. But then their hydro bills, they started to climb. In spite of heating their home with wood, their hydro bills were almost as much as their rent. Now, after 80 years living in Sunridge, Bob had to move out of his own community. He had to leave his own community. Does the acting premier think that Bob and Janine need an apology, or they need to actually have lower hydro bills?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Bob and Janine will be getting lower hydro bills come January 1st with the 8% reduction, Mr. Speaker. And I don't know the specifics of their story, Mr. Speaker, but he did mention Sundridge. Sundridge is a community, Mr. Speaker, that does get services in some parts by Hydro One, Mr. Speaker, and that means they have potential for qualifying for that 20% reduction, Mr. Speaker. That's a significant savings for that type of family and for 330,000 families right across the province, Mr. Speaker, that will qualify for that 20% reduction. But on top of that, Mr. Speaker, there are other programs in place. There's the Northern Ontario Tax Credit. There's the LEAP program if they need to access that if they're having difficulty paying their bills, Mr. Speaker. There's also the Ontario Electricity Support Program in which they will qualify for, Mr. Speaker, because he did talk about what their income is, Mr. Speaker. They will qualify and get some benefit from the ONSP program. If they're also heating their home with electricity, Mr. Speaker, then they qualify for that higher benefit. I do hope that that family gets that information so they can qualify and reduce their bills, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, last week in question period, Andrew Horvath brought stories, our leader brought stories of people who had their power cut off, even though they'd done everything they could to conserve. This is 2016, and nobody in this province should be paying as much for their hydro bill as they're paying for their rent. And nobody with a job or a pension, good savings, should find themselves in a position where they're living in the dark, where they can't afford to or they don't have electricity to keep their fridge on, their food is going bad, and they shouldn't be in a situation where mold is growing in their homes because they can't, because their basement is flooded and they can't run a sump pump. These are real stories. These are tragic realities here in this province because of the Liberal government's choices. Will the Premier ensure that no more people in this province face the reality of having their hydro cut off?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When it comes to electricity, it really is an important piece for us that vulnerable customers have the resources to help avoid disconnections. And that's why we've enhanced consumer protection rules, including requiring a 10-day advance notice of disconnection, Mr. Speaker, with accompanying resources to help customers with their arrears, Mr. Speaker. There is the LEAP program, Mr. Speaker, that will help them. Many other programs in place will help these families that are struggling, because we do agree. Everyone in this House would agree, Mr. Speaker, that it is unacceptable for families to have to live that way, Mr. Speaker, and that's why we brought forward the programs that we did in the speech from the throne. That's why we have the programs that we have, Mr. Speaker, because we are.
Member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek is warned. Carry on.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, because we are proud of the system that we built. We have a clean, green, reliable system, Mr. Speaker, in which we no longer have to send out warnings telling people to go outside and worry about breathing, Mr. Speaker, because we've eliminated coal. We're actually saving billions on our health care system. We are very proud of the system that we built, but we understand we've got to make it affordable for as many as we can.
New question. Member from Bentley, going home.
Thank you. My question again is to the Acting Premier. It's not only people that are struggling, it's also small businesses. Last year, a Liberal backbencher thought it would be a good idea to declare Tomato Day in Ontario and declare that tomato was the official vegetable in Ontario. Now, on Monday, we learned that Mucci Farms, which has been growing tomatoes in Kingsville for 45 years, is opening their newest greenhouse in Ohio because the cost of electricity is so high. Bert Mucci said, and I quote, "We are paying one of the highest rates in North America. It's causing us to move out of Ontario right now," end quote. I think most farmers would agree that they would rather have affordable hydro so they can keep their greenhouses lit up and operating rather than the tomato day. Now, will the Acting Premier take the first step towards creating more affordable electricity in this province by stopping any further sale of Hydro One?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Last week I got to meet with the Ontario Association of Greenhouse Growers, and Mr. Speaker, I know many of us had the opportunity to speak with them. And Mr. Speaker, they're growing and creating great work and creating jobs in our province, and that's under the great leadership of the Minister of Agriculture. I'd like to thank him for all of his great work, Mr. Speaker. But it is concerning when you hear about one business moving out of our province, because we are doing great things, Mr. Speaker. We now have the the ICI program, which they are thrilled with, Mr. Speaker. The Greenhouse Growers Association is thrilled with the ICI program because they will actually save, Mr. Speaker, one-third of their bill. Wow. They've actually talked about, Mr. Speaker, the natural gas expansion program that's being done by the Minister of Infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. They're very excited about that. That's a $200 million loan program, a $30 million grant program. We're going to continue to see this sector grow in this province, Mr. Speaker, because we've got the programs that are helping. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, small businesses are at their wits' end. The Windsor-Essex Chamber of Commerce says they're hearing more and more from businesses ready to relocate to Ohio or simply willing to go under because they can't afford the cost of hydro. The Kebab and Curry in Windsor is looking to closing because of their bills, because of their electricity costs. Ice Cold Treats is stuck because they can't afford to hire any staff. And just today, we've heard from pork producers who are talking about how the cost of high hydro is impacting them. Admitting a mistake is a good step, but it doesn't help any of these small businesses if it's just an apology. Will the Acting Premier do something concrete and commit to stopping the sale of Hydro One in this province?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When it comes to small businesses, we actually have many programs in place to help them, Mr. Speaker. The Save on Energy program, for example, Mr. Speaker, is saving many, many businesses thousands of dollars and conserving energy, Mr. Speaker, ensuring that we're actually saving the system costs as well. We've got the ICI program that I mentioned in my previous answer, Mr. Speaker. We also have the 8% reduction that is coming January 1st that's going to help many small businesses, Mr. Speaker. But don't take my word for that. How about Alan Odette, the CEO of the Ontario Chamber of Commerce? We are happy about this. This is the right thing to do, particularly so that medium-sized enterprises can remain competitive relative to our largest competitor, which is just across the lake. This announcement today is very significant for residents and small industry, but the most important group that would benefit will be medium-sized companies like manufacturing, Mr. Speaker. We've got business after business recognizing that the programs that we are putting in place will help them continue to grow. We'll continue to do that, Mr. Speaker, because we know that building Ontario up is the right thing to do.
Mr. Speaker, over and over we see Liberal ministers standing up in question period and patting themselves on the back about how great a job they're doing on hydro. The more and more they do that, the more and more they show the people of this province just how disconnected they are, how out of touch they are with the people of this province who are struggling to pay their hydro bills, who are struggling to pay their bills. Listen, Mr. Speaker, life is unaffordable. People are being squeezed. People at the top are doing better and better, and everyone else is paying the price. Nobody in this province voted for that. Will the government stop just apologizing for their mistakes and instead do something concrete to actually fix them?
Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, the concrete actions we have taken is 8% reduction for 5 million business and families right across the province, Mr. Speaker, effective January 1st. 20% reduction for 330,000 families, Mr. Speaker. 145,000 families qualified for the OESP program, Mr. Speaker. We're asking more families to apply to qualify. We've got five more programs, Mr. Speaker, that are helping families and businesses make sure that they can stay competitive and actually lower their hydro rates. But it's not just me that's saying this, Mr. Speaker. I talked about the Alan Odette from the Ontario Chamber of Commerce. The Financial Accountability Officer says that our electricity prices are some of the lowest in the country, Mr. Speaker. And when it comes to our energy prices, we're right in the middle of the pack. And you know who also endorsed that, Mr. Speaker? The Environment Commissioner, another officer of the House, who also said our prices are right in the middle of the pack, Mr. Speaker. We're making sure that we're building Ontario up, creating jobs, building infrastructure, something that neither one of them have a plan to do, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question? The member from Nipissing.
Speaker, every time this minister stands here to tell us something, the Financial Accountability Officer is compelled to release a report refuting what he just said.
Exactly.
The minister tells us he'll balance by 2017-18. The FAO releases a fiscal outlook that tells us they won't. Then the minister puts out a fall economic statement telling us he'll balance, but the fall FAO releases a commentary saying that's not so. Contrary to the government's fantasy numbers, the FAO says we'll have a deficit of $2.6 billion and a, quote, significant risk of structural deficits going forward. It's time the Premier and the Minister come clean with Ontario taxpayers. Mr. Speaker,
question.
Will the Minister be raising more taxes or cutting more services to fill the multi-billion dollar hole in his budget?
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, I appreciate the work done by the FAO. And as we all recognize, he does a sensitivity about some of the challenges that are faced in our economy, has done so in the past, and we've exceeded those targets. We've recalibrated and do what's necessary.
Not 100% sure.
So, Mr. Speaker, we have taken the measures necessary to grow our economy. Last quarter, Ontario outpaced the United States, the G7, and Canada. And as a result, we are taking those efforts into play. We're taking efforts to control our spending, and we've done so, being the lowest cost government anywhere in Canada as a result. And as those revenues grow and as we control our spending, we're balancing the books. And, Mr. Speaker, the FAO in his commentary references that his assumptions are actually less aggressive than ours. We have taken a more cautious approach in responding to the Auditor General, for example, in order for us to take the necessary steps to come to balance next year and the year after that.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you. Back to the Minister. The people of Ontario cannot trust anything this Liberal government has to say. Yesterday, the Financial Accountability Officer confirmed the minister's budget plan is a complete fantasy. Rather than own up to their years of waste, mismanagement, and scandals, they continue to punish Ontario taxpayers. This means more one-time fire sales, such as Hydro One, higher taxes and fees, like the $500 million more in driver's licenses, and more cuts to frontline services.
The member from Glengarry Russell is warned. I have my eye on about three others. Finish, please.
Mr. Speaker, will the minister just come clean with the Ontario taxpayers and explain whether he's raising more taxes or cutting more services to fill the multi-billion dollar hole in his budget?
Thank you, Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, let's come clean, because the member opposite always sort of misinterprets what is happening right now and always makes comparisons of some decisions that were never made in the past. We are outpacing Canada in growth. We have the highest growth, and that's identified by independent economists. And we take those assumptions and pare it down even more in order to do our projections going forward. We have the lowest unemployment in 8 years in the province of Ontario. We have actually had 641,000 net new jobs since the recession, Mr. Speaker. We have taken every step to manage our spending and control our debt by ensuring that we lock in our terms over longer periods of time. It's why our interest on debt is the lowest today that it's been since their time in office, as well as the NDP. And our accumulated deficit as a percentage of GDP is the same today as it was 25 years ago, Mr. Speaker. We're taking the necessary steps, we're investing, we're growing the economy, and we're coming to balance next year and the year after that. Thank you.
The question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Minister of Energy. In her 2014 report, the Auditor General found that the government had forced smart meters onto Ontarians without doing a business case analysis or cost-benefit analysis. The cost of the program doubled to $2 billion, just as the NDP predicted it would. And last week, we learned that time-of-use pricing had shifted less than 1% of peak demand, even though peak pricing is double that of off-peak pricing. Many Ontarians are unable to change their pattern of energy use because they need to use the power when they need to use it. Will the government stop forcing time-of-use pricing onto Ontarians?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm pleased to be able to rise and talk about some of the things that I talked about yesterday that will relate to smart meters yesterday. Yesterday, I spoke to the Empire Club. There was 300 business leaders and energy leaders there listening to what we were having to say. And what we were talking about, Mr. Speaker, is utilizing some customer choice options, right? Because right now, Mr. Speaker, we're doing the long-term energy plan consultations right across the province. And improving customer choice, allowing customers to look at choice, Mr. Speaker, is something that we need to look at, and I think that's what we're going to see come from the long-term energy plan. Smart meters will allow that to happen, Mr. Speaker, because right now it is an interesting thing when we have condo dwellers in downtown Toronto, for example, on the same price plan as seniors who are living in a bungalow, for example, in my great riding of Sudbury or in Sault Ste. Marie or in St. Catharines, Mr. Speaker. So looking at some of those options, Mr. Speaker, would be important, and that was the foresight that this government had by bringing forward the smart meters, Mr. Speaker, and making sure that we implemented that so we can actually continue to move forward.
Supplementary.
Well, I've never heard that called foresight before. Extraordinary. Time of use pricing punishes consumers like new moms, like seniors, like low-income families who can conserve energy but don't necessarily have the option of using it at another time. They have to use it when they need to use it. When will the minister stop punishing Ontarians by forcing them to use time of use pricing? When will you stop punishing them?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I know he hasn't heard the word foresight before, because that's actually called planning, and it's something that they don't have when it comes to the energy sector, Mr. Speaker. But we do have a plan, Mr. Speaker. Our long-term energy plan is actually looking at many things that we can do to actually help downward pressure on rates. We've talked about that, the 8% reduction, Mr. Speaker, the 20% reduction. We've talked about those quite often, Mr. Speaker. Those are great, great options and great plans for people to actually see downward pressure on rates. But we continue to find ways and look at the technology that is coming forward, Mr. Speaker. We've got storage. We've got great jobs coming in the storage sector and great ways of actually reducing our energy costs. Let's look and challenge the sector, Mr. Speaker, to be more efficient when it comes to our great supply mix that we have. There are many things that we can do, Mr. Speaker, and that's because we've built a clean, reliable power system, one that we can all be proud of and one that we can continue to enhance.
New question. The member from Eglinton Lawrence.
A question to the Minister of Agriculture. With the pork producers here, Minister, today, I have raised this before with the pork producers, and as you know, with many new Canadians, there's been a real increase in the demand for safe, reliable, respected Canadian Ontario pork. And that is coming from the new Canadians. I know in the Chinese community there's a huge consumption of pork. They love their pork. They love their Ontario pork. Can you tell me what the pork producers are doing to essentially market their wonderful, safe Ontario pork to new Canadians who are calling Ontario home?
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Excellent question. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank my colleague from Eglinton Lawrence for asking me a question today about Ontario pork. Ontario pork, of course, this morning sponsored a breakfast for all MPPs to take the opportunity to update them on what Ontario pork is doing. Mr. Speaker, there's no question about that. I've had the opportunity now on two occasions to travel with my colleague, the Honourable Michael Chan, the Minister of International Trade. We were in China in April 2015, and just 7 days ago, we just finished an extensive agricultural trade mission to India. One thing that everybody in this House should know, that the Ontario brand is known internationally around the world. It is known for safety and quality. And we're looking at ways for Ontario pork to increase their exports to every corner of the world. Because, Mr. Speaker, you and I both know that good things always grow in Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. As you know, the price of beef has gone up in Ontario in the last year. And I know when I go shopping at Lady York and Zito's in my riding, they talk about the price of beef. But I notice a lot of them are switching over to pork. Because people tell me that a good pork chop is just as good as a good steak. So what can we do to market all these wonderful byproducts of pork, whereby, again, people in Ontario finally appreciate the safety, the quality, and the integrity of Ontario pork. What else can we do to further market this wonderful, locally grown Ontario product?
Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member from Eglinton Lawrence for a supplementary. Mr. Speaker, I can assure the members of this House that I enjoy a good steak, I enjoy a good pork chop, and I enjoy a lot of good chicken. But let me tell you what we've done over the last number of years working with Ontario Pork. They've been so innovative, and now they produce a product that's very, very lean. It is being consumed on a worldwide basis, not only here in Ontario, but in other provinces in Canada and around the world. And it goes back to the fundamental thing that we have. Agriculture and agri-food contribute $36 billion to Ontario's GDP, and Ontario Pork is giving us a reputation around the world for quality each and every time.
You say it, please. You say it, please. New question, member from Stormont, Dundas, South Glengarry.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Acting Premier, this government has utterly failed to consult with reward point providers before bringing forth Bill 47 to the table and to committee. Reward points have to be accounted for as a liability on providers' balance sheets. Were this bill to go ahead and have this government micromanage the industry, programs such as Aeroplan, Air Miles, and others could leave this province altogether, cutting the consumers' access to reward point programs. Speaker, consumers have value their points, but does this government know what it's actually doing?
Thank you. Minister of Government and Consumer Affairs. Oh, right. Deputy Speaker.
Thank you.
Deputy Leader.
Okay, thank you. Speaker, to the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Minister of Government and Consumer Services.
Thank you, Speaker. I appreciate the question from the member opposite. First of all, I want to take a second and I want to commend the good member from Beaches, East York, for his leadership on this. Absolutely. His leadership brought forward Bill 47, Protecting Rewards Points Act, so I want to thank him for his leadership and for being in tune, obviously, with consumers in this particular issue. As you know, Speaker, loyalty rewards points have value, which is why our government is taking steps to protect them. And if passed, the proposed amendments to the Consumer Protection Act would ensure that these rewards points cannot be cancelled or diluted in any way. Speaker, I want all Ontarians to know that they don't need to worry if they have points that are about to expire, because we are committed to taking action on this issue. I'll have more to say in the supplementary.
There you have it. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, the amendments to Bill 47 filed by this government will give the minister the power to regulate the entire reward point industry from her office without any industry or consumer consultation.
We were at a point where I thought members were getting their questions and answers in appropriately without it, but there's a lot of dialogue going on now because of our situation. I think we need to bring it back down again, please. I need to hear it. Thank you.
Speaker, without any industry or consumer consultation, and despite the fact that the reward point account is completely a voluntary agreement, where the consumer is rewarded for free products and services for just being a loyal customer, this is just a government trying to clutch at straws to shore up its popularity. Has this government considered the impact of legislation will have on Ontarians' ability to access reward programs and their ability to redeem these points in the future. Again, can the minister explain how forcing reward point programs out of the province is actually helping?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
You know, Speaker, someone may want to stand up for big business. We're standing up for consumers in this province. And that's exactly what the member from Beaches East York was showing leadership on. In fact, as everyone knows, this particular bill will be discussed in the Standing Committee on Regulations and Private Bills today at 4 o'clock, where we'll have clause by clause and public hearings on this particular matter. So I'm really pleased with the steps that we're taking to protect consumers in Ontario. And you know, Speaker, it builds on Bill 59, Putting Consumers First Act, that helps to ban door-to-door sales and stop those aggressive tactics at the doors, set up rules for home inspectors, and also take stronger action on aggressive payday loan type establishments that are very predatory to consumers and make it very difficult for consumers to get out of that cycle. Speaker, on this side of the House, we're taking strong action to protect consumers.
Thank you. New question, the member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Acting Premier. Speaker, back in 2014, the Windsor-Essex County Chamber of Commerce identified strong potential for growth in the agri-food sector and the green post sector in my riding. Indeed, Mr. Speaker, my region boasts the highest concentration of year-round vegetable production anywhere in Canada. Yesterday, Mucci Farms in Kingsville announced that it was expanding its operations in Ohio. They cited the already high and rising costs of electricity in Ontario as their primary reason for leaving. Can the Acting Premier tell the people of my region how their homes and businesses can be powered by Liberal apologies?
Thank you, Deputy Premier.
The Minister of Energy.
Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm very pleased to rise and talk about the great things that we're doing to help small and medium-sized enterprises and the greenhouse growers of the province as well, Mr. Speaker. I had the opportunity to meet with them just last week, Mr. Speaker. They were here talking to all of us on the Hill, and they were very pleased, Mr. Speaker, to see all of the programs that we're bringing forward to actually help them and many other businesses right across the province. The ICI program, Mr. Speaker, will be a direct benefit to the Greenhouse Growers Association, but it'll also be a direct benefit to 1,000 other small and medium-sized enterprises right across the province, Mr. Speaker. They'll be able to use or reduce their electricity bills by one-third of their bill, Mr. Speaker. That's pretty exciting for many of these businesses. They'll also qualify for the 8% rebate for small businesses,
Answer.
Same as the home businesses or homes, Mr. Speaker. And it's not just us saying this, Mr. Speaker. It's the Ontario Chamber
Thank
of
you.
Commerce who also supports this program.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I've heard the Premier stand in this House and out in the public and talk in glowing terms about the potential of the agri-food sector in Ontario. Meanwhile, after more than a decade of Liberal promises to expand Highway 3 and to allow for improved access to markets for this critical sector, that promise remains unfulfilled, Speaker, after a decade. When will this Liberal government take its big red boot off the throats of rural Ontario and support affordability and prosperity for the people in rural Ontario?
Minister of Agriculture.
Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural
Affairs. Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. And last week, I know the Greenhouse Growers of Ontario were in to see my colleague, the Minister of Energy, and my colleague certainly engaged with them in a very positive dialogue on how our changes to the ICI will be very, very helpful for the greenhouse sector of the province of Ontario. We do know it's growing. Over the last 2 years, in the agri-food sector alone, we have generated 42,000 new jobs in the province of Ontario,
Excellent.
$2.2 billion in additional GDP, and we've partnered to bring in the new Herbway Parkway in Lindsay, Ontario, to make sure that Ontario products can get to the border to achieve those exports, because Ontario food is demanded around the world, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Any question, the member from Northumberland Country West.
Thank you. Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Minister responsible for Seniors Affairs. Minister, I read that last Friday you were in London to announce the 2017 round of funding for the Seniors Community Grant Program. It's my understanding that this program provides funding to the nonprofit Community Seniors Group for projects that encourage greater social inclusion, volunteerism, and community engagement. This is a great program that provides grant opportunities for small grassroots community organizations in order to benefit seniors, especially in rural areas. Can the minister please provide more details in this great program?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to begin by thanking the great member from Northumberland, Quinty West, for asking this important question about Seniors Community Grant Program. Indeed, Mr. Speaker, I was very excited to have been in London, joined by the Deputy Premier, the Honourable Member of London North Centre, for this announcement, an announcement that we are looking to invest another $2 million, Mr. Speaker, in the Seniors Community Grant. And might I add, I think it's among the best $2 million this government is spending, Mr. Speaker. In the 2016 round of funding, Mr. Speaker, this program benefited the lives of approximately 142,000 seniors through 380 projects, and nearly half of these programs were organized by small local groups to serve the unique needs of their communities. Since 2014,
answer.
We have invested $5 million, and we look forward to investing another $2 million. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the minister for her answer. Supporting over a quarter million seniors is truly an accomplishment you and this government should be proud of. In my riding, this program has helped many different agencies and programs, such as Bridge Hospice in Warkworth, St. John Ambulance, Northumberland Elder Abuse Network, Ruth Clark Activity Center in Port Hope, and Campbellford Curling Programs, Speaker. I am glad that we are acknowledging the important role seniors have and continue to play in our communities. I've heard that keeping seniors connected, active, engaged, and it's been shown to contribute to their overall health and well-being. And as I'm sure we all know, seniors in our communities are not looking for to slow down anytime soon.
No way.
But we all know that the needs of different communities are often unique from those around them.
Question.
Could the minister responsible for senior affairs provide example of these houses of the delivery of this house of the delivery of programs that senior community grant supports?
Minister responsible for seniors.
Thank you, Speaker. And again, I want to thank the member from Northumberland, Quinty West, for the question and for himself giving a number of great examples. He rattled off a long list of examples of this program in action. For me, Mr. Speaker, the programs that jump into my mind are three from the 2016 recipients. ATN Access, for example, based in London, has provided opportunities for individuals with disabilities to gain access to employment, reach their educational goals, and improve the quality of life. The SCG, the Seniors Community Grant Assistance, is also helping Youth Opportunities Unlimited, again in London, and the Youth Opportunities Unlimited has launched a pilot project that offers unique volunteer opportunities for seniors to engage with youth. Finally, Mr. Speaker,
answer.
In the interest of time, a third example, Meals on Wheels in London has used their funding to create a workshop series to educate seniors on common age requirements.
New question, the member from Halliburton, Corfe Lakes, Brock.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Energy. Yesterday, the Ontario Association of Food Banks released its annual report on hunger, putting a spotlight on the growing crisis of energy poverty in our province. The report shares the stories of low-income individuals, especially in rural areas, who can no longer afford constantly increasing hydro costs. Too many residents of my riding are suffering, and their pleas of desperation I hear at every event. My constituency office is flooded with requests for help with their hydro bills. And contrary to what the Minister of Energy says, we do help them access existing programs, but the food bank report confirms what we've been saying all along, that they're only a drop in the bucket. While the Premier has taken responsibility for the energy poverty crisis, her words do nothing to help those in my riding who go out of their way to cut back on electricity use but still see their hydro bills rise. When will the government listen to our food banks and
fix
the problem rather than offering Band-Aid solutions?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We know that some Ontarians in particular struggle with their electricity bills. We've been aware of that, Mr. Speaker, since I've taken over this ministry, Mr. Speaker. But that's because, Mr. Speaker, we had to build the system back up from the ground that they left decimated, Mr. Speaker. They actually left it decimated, Mr. Speaker. They actually relied on cheap coal, Mr. Speaker. We no longer do that. We've invested in the system. We've made sure, Mr. Speaker, that people have a system system that they can rely on. But that came with a cost, and the Premier recognizes that, Mr. Speaker. We recognize that as a government, Mr. Speaker, and that's why we brought forward the 8% reduction for all families and businesses right across the province, Mr. Speaker, and a 20% reduction as well. We also have 6 programs in place, Mr. Speaker, to help many of these families. But all of this, Mr. Speaker, I know there needs more to be done, and that's why we're moving forward with our plan, something that they don't have, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Through you, Mr. Speaker, to the minister. Well, not only are individuals paying the price for government's misguided policies, but so are our municipalities. In my riding, the City of Cort the Lakes now spends over $5 million a year for hydro. They are frustrated that delivery charges are very expensive compared to urban areas, and there seems to be no remedy. In August alone, their bill for 51 streetlights was $86 for electricity used, yet the total bill was $41,000. Global adjustment over $15,000, delivery charges over $16,000, regulatory charges, debt retirement charges, and on and on. This is outrageous, and residents will ultimately have to pay for this. So they're going to have to pay twice, first on their hydro bills and again on their tax bill. So my question to the minister is, when will your government act to help our municipalities deal with the mess that the Premier admits created?
Seated, please.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm
Minister, please.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm happy to be able to rise and answer this question because, you know, Mr. Speaker, they're talking about the debt retirement charge. That's something that we eliminated, Mr. Speaker, for all families. But that's their legacy, Mr. Speaker. They left a debt retirement charge that businesses are still paying to this day. But it's the leadership of this government that's going to eliminate that, Mr. Speaker. When it comes to municipalities, Mr. Speaker, our government has worked hard over the last 13 years to improve the provincial and municipal relationship that was abandoned by them. They downloaded everything onto the municipalities, Mr. Speaker. You can ask many of our MPPs who are actually in the municipality sector before, Mr. Speaker. Everything was downloaded on. We are no longer doing that, Mr. Speaker. We've seen $4 billion given to our municipalities, and that'll be done by 2017, Mr. Speaker. When it comes to making sure that our municipalities are saving energy, they're actually doing it through the state.
Thank you. No question. The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. The hydro rate crisis caused by this government is now putting hundreds of Hamiltonians at risk of losing the roof over their heads. The city's homelessness prevention program has run out of money because so many struggling people have needed help with their hydro bills. Wow. The government says it'll increase the funding next year, maybe. But the program is facing a $2.5 million deficit right now, caused by Liberal hydro failures. What will this government do today to ensure hundreds of people in my community can stay in their homes and keep the lights on and the heat on?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
To the Minister of Housing and responsible for poverty reduction.
Minister of Housing and responsible for poverty reduction strategy.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And I know that, you know, it goes without saying, Speaker, Ontarians should never have to choose between paying for food or their hydro bill. And the Minister of Energy has outlined a number of key things that his ministry is putting into place. You know, an 8% rebate, 20% for rural, suspending large renewable procurement. But I can say that when it comes to Hamilton, Speaker, since 2003, this government has invested over $166 million for affordable housing. Well, what does that mean in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker? In Hamilton, it means 872 affordable housing units have been created in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker. 470 affordable housing units have been repaired in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker. 294 households received down payment assistance.
Thank you. Before we move to supplementary, just a reminder that the member has been warned. You have been warned already. So, whoa, you're welcome.
Speaker, the Premier likes to call herself the Social Justice Premier. Fair enough. Yet as Housing Minister, Kathleen Wynne cut and capped funding for municipal homelessness prevention programs, leaving thousands of vulnerable Ontarians at risk. Previously, the province used to fund homelessness prevention based on need, and hydro in this province used to be affordable for all. Well, Speaker, an apology isn't quite enough anymore. What real concrete steps will this Premier take to actually bring down hydro bills and keep people in their homes?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and I'm glad the member opposite mentioned the Community Homelessness Prevention Initiative. You know, last year, Mr. Speaker, that program called CHIPPY helped almost 40,000 families across Ontario. Because of CHIPPY, Mr. Speaker, 115,000 families and individuals remain in their homes. Mr. Speaker, you know, this government doesn't need to take a lesson from the opposite side. Their platform, the NDP platform, didn't even mention the word poverty in the last election, Mr. Speaker. Come on. And now they're concerned, you know? The NDP, Mr. Speaker, have said no to higher wages for PSWs. They've said no to an increase for families who depend on the Ontario Child Benefit. Mr. Speaker, the list goes on about everything
Answer.
The NDP said no about.
Give a new question, the member from Kingston and the Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the awesome Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. Minister, support for Ontario's agriculture producers is crucial to ensuring that the province's $36.4 billion agri-food sector continues to thrive. Ontario farmers work hard to deliver top-quality Ontario produce and Ontario meat to thousands of people across the province every single day. This year, we doubled the feeder cattle loan guarantee program from $130 million to $260 million to promote the growth of Ontario's cattle industry and retain jobs within the province. We also introduced production insurance for tender fruit growers who lose their trees as a result of specific risks covered by the plan. Providing accessible, efficient support for farmers
Question.
Is part of our government's plan. Minister, can you please provide further information?
Stop the clock. That's not acceptable. It's your own member asking the question. Carry on.
Can you provide further information regarding what we're doing to support farmers and grow the economy?
Answer. Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Well, thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member from Kingston Islands for the question this morning, and I know how hard that she works, particularly with the farm community in Wolf Island in the Kingston area. We did, a short time ago, Mr. Speaker, we did double the feeder cattle load program, and we also expand production insurance to include tender fruit growers in the province of Ontario. And our government continues to have a strong commitment to address the challenges facing Ontario farmers. But, Mr. Speaker, nothing brings more tears to my eyes than when I've been in a farmer's field to see a leftover carcass of a cow or a sheep or a pig that's been ravaged by a predator, a coyote or a wolf. And I've taken the opportunity on numerous occasions, Mr. Speaker, to see what is a very tragic situation for a farmer. So we spent some time over the last number of months to look at ways to improve the wildlife compensation program in the province of Ontario to make sure, working with our municipalities, that farmers are justly compensated for their animals that are destroyed by
Supplementary.
How the Ontario Wildlife Damage Compensation Program, OWDCP, has been updated to provide Ontario's farmers with the support that they need when their animals are killed or injured by predatory wildlife. I'm sure that farmers in my riding of Kingston and the Islands know just how crucial this support is to protecting their livestock during these difficult situations. Just last night, I attended the Ontario Agricultural Sustainability Coalition reception and had the opportunity to speak with representatives from Ontario Pork, Ontario Beef and Ontario Sheep, who shared the importance of protecting their livestock in every possible way with me. We all know that supporting our farmers is important for their livelihood and will help them continue to produce some of the best products that land on our tables. It is wonderful to see the work our government is doing to support farmers so they can continue to flourish within the province of Ontario.
Question?
Minister, can you please share with the House how the sector has reacted following the announcement that the OWDCP will be updated?
Thank you. Minister?
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for Kingston Islands for the supplementary question. Indeed, effective January 1, 2017, compensation rates for animals, bee colonies and hives will be standardized right across the province of Ontario. The updated program will clearly define the requirements farmers need to meet and receive compensation. Mr. Speaker, one of the things that concerned me about our previous program was the amount of red tape that was embedded in the program. I've taken the opportunity to take a chainsaw to that red tape. So now we have a new single-stage appeal process that will provide a straightforward approach for farmers and will help to provide them with compensation even quicker. Mr. Speaker, Rob Scott, the chair of the Ontario Seed Marketing Agency, had this to say. OSMA appreciates the opportunity that Ontario gave the industry to provide input on the predation program review. Their willingness to work with the industry speaks to their commitment to ensuring that the program works for all farmers.
Thank you. New question, the member from Dufferin-Calgary.
My question is to the Minister of Health. Since 2015, I've been working with a family in Dufferin-Caledon whose daughter has PKU, a rare inherited brain-threatening metabolic disorder. As you know, people with PKU need treatment for life. My constituent has been taking Kuvan as part of a Sick Kids Hospital drug trial for the past 7 years, but now the trial is set to end and they simply cannot afford the staggering cost of Kuvan, which is $170,000 per year. On October 26, the Common Drug Review recommended the government pay for Kuvan. When will the Ministry of Health act and cover Kuvan for people with PKU?
Thank you, Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question. I know that the member opposite also appreciates that we've taken the politics out of drug funding and deciding which drugs should be made available to Ontarians. So the decision to fund all drugs, including a drug like Kuvan, which for some time has been available to Ontarians on an exceptional basis through our Exceptional Access Program. But we base our funding decisions and the availability of drugs on the best scientific evidence. And now we have a system, which is a pan-Canadian system, which allows for review on that national basis. And I know that there have been ongoing discussions with the drug review nationally as well, further submissions by the drug company. I know the Ministry is reviewing that to see if, in fact, we should make further changes to what is already a drug that's available for exceptional circumstances, and I expect we'll have a decision shortly.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Families and patients have been waiting too long for the Minister of Health to act. Kuvan is on the Exceptional Health Access Program, but the criteria is so restrictive that not a single application has been approved. It's been 6 years since Health Canada approved Kuvan. It's been over a month since the Common Drug Review recommended that the Minister of Health cover Kuvan. When will the Minister of Health make an announcement that Kuvan will finally be covered for people who have PKU?
Minister?
Well, in fact, Mr. Speaker, the Canadian Drug Review rejected in 2013 and made a negative funding recommendation for Kuvan on that time base that there was an absence of scientific evidence as to its benefit over existing measures. Notwithstanding that, we made a decision in the province to make it available for exceptional reasons. That is our current policy, but of course, as additional evidence, should it come forward to demonstrate efficacy and scientific evidence of its benefit in these, and of course, in consideration of the national process, if there is a decision made by the Common Drug Review, I earlier said Canadian Common Drug Review, to fund this drug in broader circumstances, we of course will look at that. We make our decisions. In fact, I'm not involved. I can't be involved in decisions. The ministry,
yes,
the experts within the ministry, make the decisions on the best scientific evidence available, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Beaches East York on a point of order.
Yes, thank you, Speaker. I seek unanimous consent to delay the vote on Parentage, Bill 28 and Bill 27, until after the swearing-in of the new member for Niagara West Glanbrook, and he takes his seat so that the voices of those citizens can be reflected.
The member from Beaches East York is seeking unanimous consent to delay vote. Do we agree? I heard a no. We have a deferred vote on the motion of second reading of Bill 27, an act to reduce the regulatory burden of businesses, to enact various new acts and make other recommendations and repeals. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. All members, please take their seats. Thank you. On October the 4th, 2016, Mr. Duguid moved second reading of Bill 27. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr.
Nack. Mr. Nackvi.
Mr.
Bradley.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Sanders.
Ms. Sanders.
Mr. Sousa.
Mr. Sousa.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Domerlin.
Ms. Domerlin.
Ms. McGarry.
Ms. McGarry.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Ms. Domerlin.
Ms. Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris, sir.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Mr.
Milchin. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Ronaldo.
Mr. Ronaldo.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Madame de Rosier.
Madame de Rosier.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller Perry San Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry San Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Monroe.
Ms. Monroe.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau. Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNova.
Ms. DeNova.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Tabin.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 13.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 13, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture, projet de loi.
Shall the bill be ordered for third reading? Government House Leader.
Speaker, I would ask the bill be referred to the Standing Committee on General Government.
We have a deferred vote on the motion of third reading of Bill 28, an act to amend the Children's Law Reform Act and Vital Statistics Act and various other acts respecting parentage and related registrations. Call on the members. This will be a five-minute bill. Thank you. Earlier today, Mr. Nackvi moved third reading of Bill 28. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Sandler.
Ms. Sandler.
Mr. Sousa.
Mr. Sousa.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Takara.
Mr. Takara.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. McGarry.
Ms. McGarry.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Merle.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic. Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Madame de Rosier.
Madame de Rosier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Ms. Genova.
Ms. Genova.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Vantaw.
Mr. Vantaw.
Mr. Tappas.
Mr. Tappas.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Mr. Nadishaw.
Mr. Nadishaw.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelinas.
Madame Gelinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
The ayes are 79, the nays are zero.
The ayes be 79, the nays being zero, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, quasi-quorum lecture project de loi.
The bill will now pass and be entitled as in the motion. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.